Hi everyone, today we are going to talk about Julian Rotter's social learning theory. I have divided today's topic into four parts. The first part is the law of effect. Second part is the components of social learning theory. Third part is the locus of control. And fourth part is the therapy. So to begin with the law of effect. Now the motivating factor behind social learning theory was the law of effect. Now there are few components under law of effect. We shall understand each of them individually. The first one being, individuals generally like to seek pleasant stimulation from their environment, whereas they try to avoid unpleasant stimulation. Also, there is a constant interaction between the individual and his or her environment. The fourth point is changeable, which states that personality and hence the behavior is always changeable depending upon the kind of environment and the situation that he or she is in. The last point states that the greater the life experience the individual has had, changing the behavior will then require more efforts as well as interventions. So these were the five points that were covered under law of effect. We shall move further to the second part, which is the components of social learning theory. There are three main components. The first one is the behavior potential. It is the likelihood of engaging in a particular behavior in a specific situation. The second is the expectancy. It is the subjective probability that a given behavior will lead to a particular outcome. The third one is the reinforcement value. It refers to the desirability of the outcome. Based on the component of social learning theory, Julian Rotter has come up with a particular formula, which is behavior potential is the function of expectancy and the reinforcement value. I shall explain this formula further using an example. Probability of the student studying for his exams depends on the function of his expectancy, that is studying leading to a good marks, and the reinforcement value, that is the desirability of getting good marks. Thus, if the expectancy and the reinforcement value both are high, the behavioral potential, in this case the likelihood of he studying for his exam, would also be greater. Now we move on to the third part of this theory, which is the locus of control. Locus of control is divided into two parts. The first is the internal locus of control and the second part is the external locus of control. Individuals with high internal locus of control are said to be the ones who tend to blame themselves, at the same time take responsibilities for whatever good or bad happens in their lives. Whereas individuals with high external locus of control, they tend to blame the people around them or the environment for whatever good or bad happens in their lives. Next, we move to the last part of Julian Rotter's social learning theory, which is the therapy. When the behavior is maladaptive, because the individual never learned more adaptive behavior. So, in this case, as a therapist who is practicing social learning theory, he or she will have to teach the client more adaptive forms of behavior. When there is irrationally low expectancy, it can lead to pathology. So, over here, as a therapist, you will have to increase your client's confidence in the following two ways. Give him insight into the irrationality of his or her expectancy. Attempt behavior that they have been avoiding out of fear of failure. Thus, social learning therapists always attempts to raise their clients' expectancies for reinforcement. Third is, when there is unrealistically high reinforcement value, it could also lead to pathology. Thus, the therapist here would have to help the client set more reasonable and achievable realistic goals. I hope you all have had a clear understanding about Julian Rotter's social learning theory. For more such simple and educational videos, do subscribe to my channel and do hit the bell icon to know every time I upload a new video here for you. Thank you.